The following program is from NET.
Many people don't know what racism is or how it works. Surprisingly, a United States government publication has a logical explanation. It is entitled, Racism in America and How to Combat It, published by the Commission on Civil Rights. It describes racism as an attitude, action, or institutional structure which subordinates a person or group because of his color. The same distortions in perception that make whites unconsciously feel normal and superior in relation to non-white persons have exactly the opposite effects upon the latter. Negro children learn from adults who must deal with whites that people in their own group have relatively little power and status in society. Television has devastatingly confirmed this impression because the world of normal Americans they see on the screen almost totally excludes them or shows them mainly in inferior or marginal roles. School textbooks and other educational materials confirm this view. It is therefore not surprising that many members of non-white groups unconsciously come to believe that perhaps they really are inferior. But when a person begins to believe he is inferior, he starts losing confidence in his ability to overcome any obstacles, which in turn produces failure that confirms his feelings of inferiority. The key idea of black nationalism is precisely to reverse this process by generating pride in being black instead of feelings of inferiority. Such pride is designed to lead to greater self-respect and self-confidence, and therefore to more success in overcoming obstacles. This, in turn, is supposed to reinforce self-confidence and reaffirm initial pride in being black. Although a very good document, it did contain one serious mistake. It called black people Negroes.
My sisters and brothers from Weeksville.
Jumbo!
PS 243 and Bedford-Stuyvesant and Africa and all other places where African people have gone.
Yes.
What was this place outside here once upon a time? Outside this school. What was it called?
Weeksville.
And that was over 150 years ago. And who lived there? What kinds of people lived in Weeksville?
Oh,
African people. And we say African people because we too are what kind of people?
African!
So all of this really belongs to us. This is ours. Bedford-Stuyvesant. This is Weeksville. This is a part of Africa that's been moved over to where we are. Okay. This is the kind of education which is meaningful today because we are no longer talking about history in just an isolated sense. We're trying to make history something which relates to what's happening today, because I'm sure we all feel that today that we have a need for a lot of new things, especially for our the survival of our children. And so we want them to know about patterns of family living as it existed in Africa, as we can find today even in South America, so that where people have lived and survived under oppression, under exploitation, how they've done this is the question that we're asking. We're standing now in Bedford-Stuyvesant in Brooklyn, New York. And what you see happening is a part of the community itself digging up its racial pride. You see Boy Scouts down there digging now, and others have been digging for the last few years old houses that have been torn down going down in old basements, digging out of old wells, and finding that once here, in this very spot where we are, there existed a colony of black people, free people, who lived together in this place called Weeksville. And through the efforts of everyone, from senior citizens to the youngest child, the community itself has been trying to revive its past and to rediscover its heritage and to use it to make themselves feel stronger and prouder of who they really are. And our project, Project Weeksville, is involved with all of these things. Urban archaeology, we're doing historical research, we're trying to find new methods of rediscovering what happened during the 19th century to the groups of black people who lived here. We're also bringing it up to date, trying to use it in education, especially with our younger children, so that we are doing teacher training, we're writing curricula, we are doing all sorts of experimental cultural programs so that we can see what really happens to people when they start themselves becoming involved in finding out who they are, and especially doing something, not just sitting reading a book about it, but digging with a pick and a shovel and going in old houses and seeing children themselves become transformed from small little capsule people into people of the whole world. Now when we say Wazoo Wazuri, we say beautiful people, we are talking about you and all the things that you're going to become in this world, like who knows what parents might become. Because we come from a long line of beautiful warriors and kings and queens. There were great kingdoms in Africa where people had libraries, where there were scholars, Monique, there were scholars, people who could read books, who wrote books, people who wrote books, the books that you read. These were all in Africa, Tracy. Now, we know a few words in Africa. We know that we are African people, no matter where we are. Now, let's say our chant that we say. Once upon a time,
all of black children in the world.
So that when we speak about our sisters, we say what word?
Dada!
All right, well, all the Dadas hold up their hands.
No.
All the Dadas. And this doesn't mean just a certain age. This doesn't mean 5 years old or 6 years old. It means 50 years old, 30 years old. Now, what's another word? What's the word for a lion?
Simba!
All right, would all the Simbas hold up their hands? Let me see all of my symbols. That means you are the warriors of our people. All right, let me hear you say that word again.
Simba!
Once more.
Simba!
Simba, you are the one we will follow. We will look up to you because you are going to protect us always. Isn't that right?
Yes.
Aren't they handsome sisters?
Yes.
Don't they have some beautiful brothers?
Yes.
Beautiful Simba.
Simba.
What began with the discovery of relics from a black community dating back to the Civil War period has mushroomed into a coordinated program including black historical research, scientific study of the remains, and a different approach to educating black children. Working on Project Weeksville, along with Director Barbara Jackson, a former Syracuse University professor, our brother Robert Swann, research scientist in charge of historical research, and William Harley, a longtime resident in charge of the archaeological digging.
But this is one of the old jars that was dug up across the street in Weeksville. This here army boot came out of an attic of a house across the street. This was a Civil War. This here is a shoe lash for a small child. In those days, the father used to mend the children's shoes, which is known as cobbling. This here is a chimney sweep. The Indians call it a bison. Well, this here was let down in the chimney from the top of the roof. Then the guy in the bottom would pull down, and the fellow on the roof would pull up, up and down. That's how they got to sit out the chimney.
We can also say that we're trying to dig out black pride by investigating the history of Weeksville. Because here we have a community, a black community that existed approximately in the early 1830s that was apparently self-contained. Here on the map you can see we have the small community is located right about here, where you have a colored school, you have two churches, a Baptist church and African Methodist church, you have an African Civilization Society branch, you also have a Howard Orphan Asylum, and you have a home for the aged, all existing within this small community in Bedford-Stuyvesant about 125 years ago. The white press characteristically described Weeksville as a rundown, drunken, dirty, infested community. But historical research evidently shows that this is not really true. The fact that you have at least a half a dozen social and economic institutions where the blacks ran and administered these institutions themselves sort of contradict this.
The most important document uncovered by Mr. Harley's group is this constitution and bylaws of an organization called the Abyssinian Benevolent Daughters of Esther Association.
Well, this was found in the attic of a house across the street in 1601 Dean Street. The Order of the Abyssinian Daughters of Esther were a group started by black women, because in those days the whites wouldn't insure no blacks in the insurance company. So they formed this organization of their own.
The bylaws, for example, stated that persons had to contribute, let's say, 50 cents a month to the organization. And if anyone got sick, they were entitled to, let's say, $2 a month until they were well or out of bed. They were also had provisions for burial benefits. Like each person, each member who died was allowed $20 for burial.
Mr. Harley's weekly visit to the classroom is a source of great delight to the children and serves to introduce them to the history of their community.
How are we going to sing our song? What's the name of the song?
Mr. Dooley!
Mr. Dooley was a fisherman. And every time he used to come up around Troy Avenue when I was your age, he used to sing this song, Mr. Dooley.
Oh, Mr. Dooley! Oh, Mr. Dooley! Oh, Mr. Dooley, Dooley, yeah, yeah.
Now, it seems like this is pretty far away from history, but this is really the kind of history we're talking about, because we take the children in this Weeksville project with all these different components that we have. We take them back to Africa and they learn about their heritage, and then they learn about other things that have happened to African people around the world. And then most important, most significant to them, I think, is that we can bring it right here in Bedford-Stuyvesant, so that these children in this school can look outside the window and say, you know, once upon a time, not too long ago, we had a community here of people. And they can see the kinds of things that Mr. Harley can show you, that he's been digging up, that the people actually used. And then they can translate this in their imaginative ways. Like, these are some surviving houses from Weeksville, which have been made into historical landmarks.
A lot of people in Brooklyn, been in here a long time, never seen this place. They never heard of it. These old houses were built around 1820 to 1830. The Landmark Commission has just made these houses a historical landmark. And our intentions are to preserve these old houses and make a museum out of it, so we'll have a black museum in the Bedford-Stuyvesant area.
One of the objectives of historical research is oral history. Since most of black history is not recorded in primary sources, we've developed a method whereby we are interviewing our senior citizens in an attempt to extract the memories of the past, the memories of black history, from their minds and put it on paper.
Well, they just said it was an old-time colored neighborhood, and that the proud colored people came there, and they were very independent. and they was trying to make a way of their own, an ordinary life, what we call today, pulling yourself up by your bootstraps.
You know, my father drove a coach along the Hunter Fly Road. Now they call it Hunter Fly Place. And if my father was alive today, he'd be about 120-some years old. And when he came from Ohio, he was a coachman, and he wore those boots looked like patent leather boots and fancy pants and a long frock tail coat and a high hat and a big long whip. And the carriage that he drove, just like, say, that a Rhodes, you would say, that was the doctor's car, Rhodes, that he run in. They call it a runabout. Just was one seat in there.
Yeah.
And he would get in there, the doctor would throw the bag in there, and he'd say, Kearns, take me over to such a place in Brooklyn down Flatbush. Go through Hunter Fly Road to make a shortcut to King's Highway. That was a shortcut that used to run right all the way over, across this place here,
Fulton Street,
and down into Williamsburg.
Yeah.
I can picture and see it too, just as well as good as today. Of course, I'm not all that old, though, now.
I'm
in my 70s, that's all.
Well, that's about all that I can remember, because I stayed at my job more or less, because there was more cars. I used to walk from down South Brooklyn all the way down to Coney Island. Sometimes I'd pick up $3, $4, $5 a day at a quarter a shot. A man would be stuck with his car, and I stand by, and I said, so-and-so-and-so is wrong with it. And I call that automobile psychology. And then finally the man look up and say, hey, young fella, you know anything, what's wrong with this D thing? And I say, sure, you want me to start it? He says, sure. And I'd get out my hammer, screwdriver, and a pair of pliers. They each used to cost a dime a piece in those days. And the screwdriver was iron. Some of it had wood on it. The pliers was nothing, but I'd fix anything what was wrong with it and get it started. And when I got through, he said, hold on, how much I owe you, young fellow, with a big smile on his face? I said, 25 cents. 25 cents? It only took you 15 minutes, gee whiz.
The idea of Project Weeksville is to help the children see the continuity of Black history, linking Africa to Weeksville, and then to present-day Brooklyn. Here they recreate African village scenes. The Simbas, or brothers, bring their day's catch of fish in their boats. Then the Dadas, or sisters, come to the riverbank and receive the fish. Finally, all join in a dance of celebration. Study of our African heritage is designed to instill in the children an awareness of their cultural past and will generate a pride in being Black. This should in turn help them in dealing with their everyday life problems. The now infamous Irish Draft Riots of 1863 took place in New York City at the beginning of the Civil War. Thousands of Blacks were murdered in the bloodiest riot in American history. Weeksville was the Black community to which many Blacks escaped to safety.
The racial relations at that time were really horrible. You have a tremendous polarity between the Blacks and the Irish, for example, simply because the history of the war itself more or less induced this tension, because it was more or less a discrimination against the lower class. And the lower class Irish took their frustrations out on the easiest people to take their frustrations out on. The whites, in order to avoid the draft, had to pay $250 or $300, and they could avoid the draft. But being poor white, they didn't have that money, so they started a riot, and they directed it against the Negroes, the persons that were supposed to have been the cause for the war. And during the draft riots, they destroyed a lot of institutions. The Black orphan asylum in New York City was totally destroyed. They just wreaked havoc throughout the city. Most of the Holocaust was done in New York City, where a lot of Blacks were killed, were lynched, were mobbed, were beaten, and which caused a lot of the Blacks to flee to Brooklyn, and they sought refuge in Weeksville. There were no riots in Weeksville per se, because the men, which was reported by the Christian reporter of that time, July 13th, that the men of Weeksville defended themselves with arms, picks, shovels, whatever have you, to protect their community against the rioters and the looters.
What would that do to a fella?
To put a hole big enough to put your fist in. All you need was an undertaker. You wouldn't need no doctor.
During Weeksville, people were living under a lot of pain. There was a lot of conflict going on, so that they had to take care of themselves, help each other, and build this kind of beautiful unity that we're talking about so much today, that we want across the country and all of our communities, a unity or umoja, as it's called in Swahili, which makes even our children able to make the kinds of things and to think the kinds of thoughts about themselves which make them stay and survive and get a strength.
Because of Project Weeksville's unique approach, Black history and culture have come alive again in the Bedford-Stuyvesant community of Brooklyn. In the coming months, the project will continue to unearth and study the real history of Weeksville, develop curriculum to be used in the schools, and eventually they hope to establish a Black museum to house the artifacts they have discovered. All a part of digging for Black pride.
Working in plain clothes and posing as drunks or Johns, presumably looking for prostitutes and robbers, members of the Detroit Police Department's stress unit since May 11 have killed 9 Black men and teenagers. Stress stands for Stop the Robberies, Enjoy Safe Streets. Recently killed were a 14 and 16-year-old. They were killed by Richard Warbeck, a white patrolman wounded in an alleged shootout with the Republic of New Africa in Detroit in 1969. Intended or unintended, execution on the spot has been the punishment for these alleged street crimes. The Committee for a Unified Newark, headed by Imamu Baraka, recently hosted the Eastern Regional Conference of the Congress of African People. They met to develop and clarify goals and programs for Black political and economic freedom. CAP's major resolution was to form a national Pan-Africanist political party and to form statewide Black political tickets. Representative Charles Diggs, chairman of the Congressional Black Caucus, returned from a tour of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration installation in racist South Africa. He termed it, quote, an extremely emotional experience. He stated that Blacks are not allowed even in NASA's dining room and charged that, quote, the countdown has begun on apartheid, and predicted that the U.S. will have a say in whether changes can come by peaceful means or in, quote, a bloody Holocaust. Pontiac, Michigan has come to be known as the 1971 Little Rock. Court-ordered busing of nearly 9,000 children has created a terribly tense atmosphere. In February 1970, a federal district judge found Pontiac schools guilty of segregation for the past 16 years. Busing plans were implemented to enforce integrated education, thus touching off one of the most tense and troublesome situations of this kind in any northern city. In late August of this year, 10 school buses were destroyed by bombs, and the FBI arrested the former Grand Dragon of the Michigan Ku Klux Klan and 6 Klan members, and charged them with conspiracy to violate the public education section of the Federal Civil Rights Act, to violate federal bomb statutes, and to obstruct federal court orders. White parents attempted to physically restrain the buses and conducted absenteeism strikes. Some Black mothers were fearful for the safety of their children.
I just have one child here, and I kept him home yesterday out of fear. I guess I know how Black people in the South must have felt when they had to send their kids into a white neighborhood. The crowd here this morning wasn't violent. They didn't act like they were, but if they had been, I would have been here anyway, because I want my child to get a good education. There are 3 of us here. There are probably about 60 white people here, maybe about 10 Black. I don't have anything, but in our little group, we have enough for about 6 of them if they put a hand on any Black child.
Why don't you believe in the busing?
I just don't believe in it. I'd rather for my child to be in a neighborhood school. You know, if I want him to be bused, he would be in a private school. You know, not out here. You know, you take a poor whitey and an ignorant nigger, put them together, you ain't got it. That's right. and I don't want him out here no way, you know. But I intend for him to come and go safely. That's why I'm here. And I will be here until it gets straightened up.
In the world of sports, the winningest team in college football this year is obscure University of Toledo in Ohio, led by a brother, quarterback Chuck Ely. Ely, a senior from Portsmouth, Ohio, has a 56% pass completion record and leads the nation's quarterbacks and has had the fewest passes intercepted. The Toledo Rockets have 23 straight victories.
A sample of letters from our viewers. Gerald Thomas from Oklahoma City writes, I would like to say that the weekly presentation of Black Journal is a source of enlightenment. Lawrence X. Armstrong of Rahway State Prison sends this poem. We, the society's so-called socially rejected, have a nation. We know we belong, and once a week it has become our duty to watch Black Journal. For more information on Black Journal, send for our free brochure to Black Journal, 10 Columbus Circle, New York, 10019. Some blacks have criticized the movie Sweet Sweetback as being exploitive. Other blacks have praised it as being a tool of liberation. The truth? You decide next week on Black Journal. Is Sweetback really sweet? This week, we dedicate our Black National Anthem to the proud black youth of Weeksville and elsewhere who are discovering their heritage.